Good morning, everyone. Just like to welcome you here to St. Rose of Lima Parish, Marge's church of many years, for the celebration of her funeral mass, and thank you again on behalf of her family for your prayers and support. Before we begin our liturgy here this morning, her daughter Patty would like to share some memories on behalf of the family.
Thank you all for coming to support my family and to remember my mother. Margaret, Maggie, Nurse Del Rossi, Mrs. Robert Giuliani, Aunt Margie, Marge, Mommy, Mrs. J, Grammy. However you came to know my mother, you know she was a very intentional person, incredibly deliberate. Everything was meticulously planned and detailed. When Lenny found the note in her Dear family, if anything should happen to me, I am saying goodbye to you now. I want you to know that you are the very best thing that has ever happened to me, and that you have always been my constant joy and pride. I don't know what I ever did to deserve such a wonderful husband and children. Take good care of each other and remember me. Love, Mom. I hope she knows that she was the best thing that ever happened to us, and we could never forget her.
In baptism, Margaret died with Christ and rose with him to new life. May she now share with him eternal glory. Let us pray. O God, Almighty Father, our faith professes that your Son died and rose again. Mercifully grant that through this mystery, your servant Margaret, who has fallen asleep in Christ, may rejoice to rise again through him, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Please be seated, and Miles will read a passage from the book of Job.
Peace be with you. A reading from the book of Job. Job answered Bildad and Shuhite and said, "Oh, would that my words were written down. Would that they were inscribed in a record, that with an iron chisel and with lead they were cut in the rock forever. But as for me, I know that my vindicator lives, and that he will at last stand forth upon the dust, whom I myself shall see. My own eyes, not another's, shall behold him. And from my flesh I shall see God. My inmost being is consumed with longing." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Beside restful waters, he leads me. He refreshes my soul. The Lord is my shepherd. There is nothing I shall want. He guides me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though the table before me in the spot of my foes. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Only goodness and kindness follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord for years to come. The Lord is my shepherd. There
Aidan will now read a passage from St. Paul's first letter to the Corinthians.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead came also through a man. For just as in Adam all die, so too in Christ shall all be brought to life, but each one in proper order. Christ the first fruits, then at his coming, those who belong to Christ. Then comes the end, when he hands over the kingdom to his God and Father. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death, for he subjected everything under his feet. But when it says that everything has been subjected, it is clear that it excludes the one who subjected everything to him. When everything is subjected to him, then the Son himself will also be subjected to the one who subjected everything to him, so that God may be all in all. The word of Lord.
Reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You have faith in God, have faith also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If there were not, would I have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you, and I will come back again and take you to myself, so that where I am, you also may be. Where I am going, you know the way." Thomas said to him, "Master, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. On behalf of the parish of St. Rose of Lima, I want to offer my condolences to all of Marge's family and friends, certainly to her husband, Bob, and to her children, Bob, Patty, and Lynn, and her sister, Edna, and the grandchildren, five grandchildren. I think it's Aidan, Dana, and Ryan, and Jonathan, and probably Dylan. I don't know how you keep track of all of those people, Bob. But we have Marge and her family and our prayers, and you know, it's always difficult to lose someone that you care about. And you know, and yet I really believe that a time of loss, a time of suffering like this is a wonderful time for self-examination. You know, we really think about Marge and what was her life about, and the 85 years, you know, the 85 years that she would have seen, my understanding is that always a resident of Camden County, interestingly, you know, she was born in Camden when the family lived in Camden, and passed from this life in Our Lady of Lourdes Hospital in Camden City. And Yet, in those 85 years of life, the changes that she would have seen, the experiences that she had, the accomplishments, the disappointments, all the things that we go through in our life. And really now, I'm sure that Marge, for all of you, would have been a fixture in your life, that she was someone who was there for the family gatherings. She was someone who was at the other end of the phone and she would share an accomplishment and give you a congratulations or be a shoulder to cry on at those difficult times. And yet, after those 85 years of life, Marge is no longer with us. And we ask ourselves, that should make us ask ourselves, well, really, what did Marge's life ultimately mean? And there's another question that should bring on immediately. What really does my life mean? What is my life about? What is my life supposed to be about? And I really like the readings that the family picked. Our first reading from Job, where Job, who is suffering tremendous difficulties and believes that he may be on the point of death, is saying, "Were that my words were written down, were that they were carved in stone with an iron chisel and with lead," because his life, he knows whatever difficulties he faced, whatever accomplishments he had, he made a difference. And isn't that really what you think about with Marge? Marge, we are all here to celebrate, to acknowledge the difference that Marge made by her life. That you're different. You're a different person because you've known her. And I had the privilege of meeting on Friday with Lynn and his wife, Diana, and hearing stories about Marge and her life. And that she was a nurse for almost 52 years. And it's interesting. I know a lot of nurses. There are a lot of medical people who are in the church. And nurses in particular, they're very faithful people. I think dealing with life and death kind of does that to a person. But also, it's interesting, as Patty said, what I heard was she was a very meticulous person. And, nurses tend to be that. I think record-keeping is at the heart of medical care, really. But what was that really about? What does that mean in terms of the difference that Marge made? And when in the hours ahead, in the days ahead, in the years ahead, you'll get together, you'll share stories about Marge. What is important? And I'm confident, when you're talking about Marge, you're not going to talk about how much money she had in the bank, the kind of clothes that she wore. What are you going to remember about Marge? It is about relationship. It is about a person who cared about others, that is the heart of nursing. Success, being fulfilled in a nursing career, it means caring for people, caring about people. And I understand that she loved the kitchen. She loved to cook. Cooking is, I love to eat, so I have a great appreciation for cooking. And it is interesting that it is a hobby. It's an avocation that is about other people. It's complicated. It's fun to put dishes together. But who enjoys cooking for themselves? It's always about nourishing and caring for another person. What does that tell us? I mean, when we gather here, we think about Marge. We think about her life. Well, what is my life about? And there's an interesting human experience. I see it in myself. I see it in my family and parishioners. There's something we all go through. I think God made us this way, that we have responsibilities in life, that as we go through life, from the time that we're children, there are projects which we wish to accomplish. I mean, there was a time when you were in school. Some of you are in school right now. And, we're in school, and it's important to study. You want to get good grades. We look forward to graduating. And for all of us here, there was a time when you'd finished the whole school thing, and now it's time to look for a job. And you're being responsible. You're being prudent. You're looking for a job. You want a career, a job that allows you to care for your family and where you can find fulfillment. Or, maybe you've got a job, and it's a good job, but, you deserve a promotion. You deserve a raise. And there's the interesting human characteristic I certainly see in myself. but in almost everyone I talk to, that when we have a project which we desire to accomplish, and when we're working towards this, the big project, we have this idea, we can kind of take on a mindset that whatever difficulties, whatever little things are going on in my life, you know, this is what's important. When I graduate, when I get the job, when I get the promotion, that's when my life is going to change. That's when things will start to work. And all of us have accomplished some of those successes and seen our lives not change. Well, what really are our lives about? You know, God made every one of us to want to contribute. We have an innate desire to be a participating member of the community of the family, the community of the neighborhood, the community of the church, however it works out. That is where we look for fulfillment. And the secret is what Job was alluding to. It is about relationship. It is about lived relationships lived authentically. And ultimately, Job would say, whatever's going on in my life, the one thing I know is that my Redeemer lives. And the message there, and the message from St. Paul is, whatever's going on in life, we should remember, we need to remember that the point of our lives is our relationships. It's not the stuff that we have. It's not the stuff that we desire. It is about the people that we care about, the people who care about us. And ultimately, as St. Paul said, as Job wants us to realize, first and foremost is our relationship with God. That was something that Marge took seriously. It's something that we, in our lucid moments, will take seriously, that when we're wondering what's going on in life, where am I supposed to be, what am I supposed to do, we'll turn to God. But, you know, it's just like our relationship with God is just like our relationship with the people we care about. We have to communicate. We have to be present. And God is, fortunately, that person who gives our life direction and meaning. The family allowed me to pick this gospel, and it's a wonderful gospel from St. Paul. And one of the things I find particularly appropriate about it, it's from the Last Supper. Here, as we enter into Holy Week, we're preparing to celebrate, you know, the passion of Christ, his resurrection. This is at the Last Supper. Christ is giving his marching orders to the apostles. He's explaining to them, what are they going to do after the resurrection? What is their role in life? What is God's plan for them? And he tells them it is about their relationship with him and how the message, the gospel they bring to us is our relationship with Christ. In the decisions and the challenges of life and the accomplishments, the joys, the sorrows. You know, Christ says to you and I am the way, the truth, and the life. Christ is that truth that shows us the way to authentic life. You know, Christ reveals to us who we are and where we're supposed to go, how we are supposed to reach fulfillment. Now, how do we do that? And you know, it's just our relationship with Christ is just like our relationship with the people around us. And part of it is being present. That's why we're here. Why are we here this morning? In the busyness of life, you know, on this Monday morning, we come together and we all have a lot of things to do. But when we lose someone we care about, we stop and we instinctively come together as a community. Why? We're certainly here to honor Marge's memory, to honor the person that she was. We're here to offer consolation and help to the family, to Marge's family, to everyone who grieves, to each other. But we need to remember fundamentally what really is wonderful, what really is a tremendous gift from God. In God's infinite generosity, he allows you and me to offer for Marge's eternal well-being the greatest gift that God has given to us, the presence of Christ among us. Christ promised to be with his people to the end of time. He fulfills that here and now in the sacrament of the Eucharist. And we remember when we celebrate the Mass, we come into the presence of Christ. The Eucharist is Jesus Christ. And just being here, that's a gift that we offer for Marge, and it's a gift that's offered to us. It is a transformation that Holy Week is really all about, trying to help us to understand. And we're called to a relationship with Christ, but we have to live that. We have to respond to that relationship. We have to respond with the gift of self. And you know, St. Paul in his first letter, three chapters before our second reading today, he points out that, you know, the chalice is a participation in the blood of Christ. The Eucharist is a participation in his very body. But before to receive Holy Communion is a promise. It's a promise of relationship that, and as St. Paul would say, at least since the last time I went to confession, I live and I believe what the Catholic Church teaches. And there are times, you know, in personal integrity, you know, we're saying publicly and with personal integrity, I believe these things, I live these things. And there are times when honesty won't allow us to come forward and receive communion. We remember why Christ came into the world. He offers us a transformation from simply focusing on the material benefits of life and the ability to live that promise, that supreme calling that God has for each one of us. You know, Christ would, in his preaching, would frequently imply, he would say that there is a message, there is a mission for every living human being. It's unique to each individual human being, but it is always about relationship lived authentically. Stand, and Dana will lead us in the prayer of the faithful. Jesus Christ is risen from the dead and sits at the right hand of the Father, where he intercedes for his church, confident that God hears the voices of those who trust in the Lord Jesus, we join our prayers to his.
Our response to these petitions is, Lord, hear our prayer. In baptism,
stand. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. As we humbly present to you these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant Margaret, We beseech your mercy that she who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Savior may find in him a merciful judge who lives and reigns forever and ever. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord, in him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim. Font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Dennis, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and with all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. Let us offer each other a sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Catholics in union with the church may now come forward for Holy Communion. body of Christ.
Please join in singing our communion hymn, I Am the Bread of Life, number 342 in your hymnal, number 342.
The body of Christ.
Day.
The body of Christ.
On the
Please stand. Lord God, whose Son left us in the sacrament of his body, food for the journey, mercifully grant that, strengthened by it, our sister Margaret may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Come back. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our sister. May our farewell express our affection for her. May it also ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. Because when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself, we will be reunited with our sister and with Christ. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our sister Margaret in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, she will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon Margaret in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant. And help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our sister forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord. In peace, let us take our sister to her place of rest.
Precious Lord, take me. precious Lord, lead me home. When the darkness appears,